The Q&A is back next year, still at 9:30. Sorry, Mr. Peters. But we're moving to Monday nights, and we are very happy about that. So, Monday nights, 9:30 next year, so do watch out for that. And we are very pleased that New Zealand On Air is funding us for another 40 episodes of Political Current Affairs. Let's bring the panel in now for one last wrap-up. Jennifer, I wonder if the government, watching that youth panel we had on a few moments ago, how they would be feeling about that. There wasn't a lot of enthusiasm for Kiwi Build, certainly an appetite to see them do something about mental health.
Yeah, but I think they had an overall optimism about their place in New Zealand. I do think what it reminds us is that young people, we talk about them as millennials as if they're a single cohort, but they're all really diverse group of young people, so we can't talk about youth quakes and the youth vote as if it's something monolithic. I do think there's a real opening for political parties to be getting in touch with first-time voters and really working a bit harder around mobilising them, because if this is the sample of young people out there, then there's a real opportunity for political parties to be talking to them more and getting new ideas about what society should be looking like.
John Tamihere, where do you think we've ended up at the end of this year? Will the government be happy? I mean, National's got 46, but the leader who's being questioned... Labour, will they take the 43% in the polls?
Oh, yeah, look, I think, once again, it's the context. You had three parties thrown together. They had to form some form of coalition government, some form of understanding in a matter of weeks. They did that. And they've had to craft their way through this by putting the architecture together after the event. Notwithstanding that, I think they've done very well. National, on the other side, as a consequence of that, have held numbers, but they still have not got one poll in that has allowed them to govern. They still do not have any support parties that can get them across the line
The Greens are teetering, though, aren't they, on 5%, Liam? Are they going for the strategy of just trying to make it alone?
Well, this is the thing. This is the only way that National can win in 2020. New Zealand First under 5%, the Greens under 5%. And as your own poll showed, that's actually not outside the realms of possibility. Now, there's still a little bit to go, and obviously there's 2 years almost before an election. But I think National can be pretty pleased with the fact that it has held the ground. I mean, part of that reflects the fact that it's got a monopoly on the centre-right vote. It doesn't have to share that with anybody else. But if you look at where you're sitting a year out from losing government and you're within 1 point of getting back in, you've got to be pretty happy.
But there's this constant speculation about the leader. Somebody is leaking. There's a destabilisation going on there. If they were to change the leader, that might really damage them.
It would. It would be a mistake for National to change leadership. You don't want to get on the carousel of death that Labour was on.
But he's got a 7% preferred Prime Minister. He isn't connecting with the public.
Yes, but he's got 46% of the party vote. And the party vote's what determines the government. Now, I do want to push back a little bit on that, because I think that, at the end of the day, if the chips fall where they are and National has the biggest party and has a majority, well, then it's going to be the government. It doesn't matter if the leader is less popular. We just had an election where the second most popular leader became the Prime Minister. Now, it's not the same kind of gulf, but it goes to show that fundamentally, under an MMP system, it's the party vote that determines the government.
OK, Jennifer, I'm going to bring you in here as the political scientist. Do you agree?
Oh, well, I mean, we're still 2 years out. What I would say is if we do a retrospective and compare Brash with Bridges and their standing, I mean, of course, the situation was different. But in 2006, Brash was on, 20% favourability as preferred Prime Minister. The party was in the mid-40s, just looked exactly like now, and Key was on 7%. And by the end of that year, Key was leader. So all I'm saying is that the party vote in itself isn't going to save Bridges if there is somebody else who believes that they can take the party to 48 or 49% and shore up that opportunity in 2020.
OK, final word, JT. Bridges, is he safe? Is he going to last?
No, I think he's a very capable guy. I think he's been underrated. But I just can't see him lasting. And the reason for that is that 9 years, he gets the poison chalice. After 9 years, he's trying to assert himself. And you've got a new and dynamic narrative starting to ride out here, politically, globally, and he's running into that. He's also got some outstanding talent in his own caucus who believe they can do a better job, and that is the nature of politics. Caucuses and factions will form, and I don't anticipate him last until the end of this year.
All right. Panel, thank you very much for your time and your efforts throughout the year. That's it for Q&A this year. Thank you again to the panel and the guests, the crew, the camera operators, everyone who's helped with this show. Thank you for watching at home and your contributions. Those were the questions, those were the answers. That's Q&A. Merry Christmas, and we'll see you in the new year. Catch you later. Q&A is made with the support of New Zealand On Air.